heads full of stars.
On the 23rd of June, 1965, at around 9 p.m. in the Montrose neighborhood in Houston, Texas, police accompanied Marvin Marlin to the home of his elderly aunt and uncle at 1815 Driscoll Street to perform a wellness check. Marvin hadn't heard from the elderly couple in a few days, and a visit to the house revealed the doors locked and the blinds down. After no answer at the front door, police walked around to the back of the house looking for another way in. At the back door, they found flower pots piled against the entrance, forcing them to push through into the house. Once inside, they observed that, while the house was a little messy, it seemed otherwise normal. There was no sign of the couple, and no sign of their son, who lived with them. Strange, though, that there was dinner on the table, as if their disappearing was not planned. One of the police officers walking around the home walked into the kitchen and later recalled the whole scene just didn't feel right. Something strange was in the air. For no real reason other than curiosity, the policeman opened the fridge. The shelves were jammed with what looked like hog meat. A little unusual to have just left all of that in there to spoil. And then, as he was closing the door to the fridge, he caught a glimpse of a pair of lifeless eyes staring back at him from a vegetable drawer. And I think we all know where this is going. Charles Frederick Rogers was born to Fred and Edwina Rogers on December 30th, 1921. Not much is known about his childhood growing up with Fred and Edwina, but Charles was said to be extremely intelligent. In the fall of 1942, he enrolled at Texas A&M University, but only attended for about a month before dropping out. He then enrolled at the University of Houston, where he earned a Bachelor of Science degree in nuclear physics. He then joined the Navy, where he was a pilot during World War II and served in the Office of Naval Intelligence. After his discharge from the Navy, he worked as a seismologist for the Shell Company for a time, and at some point in the 1950s was involved with the Civil Air Patrol, which is a federally supported nonprofit corporation that serves as the official civilian auxiliary of the United States Air Force. It was there that Charles Rogers met David Ferry, one of the men later accused by New Orleans District Attorney Jim Garrison of being involved in the plot to assassinate President John F. Kennedy. David Ferry was eventually played by Joe Pesci in the movie JFK. Is any of this relevant? Most likely not, but we'll get to that. After working for Shell for 9 years, Charles abruptly and without explanation quit in 1957 and moved back in with his parents, Fred and Edwina, on 1815 Driscoll Street, where he lived in the attic and, by all accounts, became a loner and a recluse. According to relatives, Charles only communicated with his parents by passing notes under the door and did all of his own cooking in his room via a hot plate. Someone who lived next to the Rogers for 7 years was unaware they even had a son, and almost everyone was surprised to learn that it was Charles that actually owned the house the family lived in on Driscoll Street. Charles would get up early in the morning and leave before his parents were awake, be gone all day, and would return late at night after his parents had gone to sleep. No one knew where he went or what he did all day. It is also unknown why the relationship was so cold between the parents and their son, though there is speculation that Fred and Edwina were physically and emotionally abusive towards Charles for his entire life, including into adulthood.
Do you do want to talk to the son?
That is correct, Bob. We do know that the boy lived with his parents, and as of this minute, we have not been able to locate him, or neither do we know too much about him.
On that night, the 23rd of June, 1965, after the discovery of the contents of the fridge, investigators were quickly called in. Inside the fridge, stacked on the shelves, were the butchered bodies of Fred and Edwina Rogers, cut into many small pieces. Before dismemberment, the bodies were drained of blood and had the organs removed and flushed down the toilet, to be later found in the sewage system. The killer then cleaned and neatly piled the pieces of their torsos and limbs in the fridge, which is why the police officer didn't immediately recognize what he was looking at. You just don't expect to open a fridge and see chopped up people cleaned and piled neatly inside.
We just opened the refrigerator up, you know, just out of curiosity. And when we opened it up, well,
All we could see was just meat packed in there. You couldn't get anything else in there because it was just completely full of meat. As it was getting ready to close the refrigerator, the vegetable bin down at the bottom is glass. And as I started to close the refrigerator, well, I seen the head of one of them, and then I knew what the rest of it was.
The house had been thoroughly washed clean, except for some blood found in the upstairs bathroom, where police believe most of the butchering occurred, and a bit of blood in Charles's room in the attic, where they also found a handsaw they believed was one of the tools used to dismember the elderly couple. Autopsies on what was left of the bodies later concluded that the couple was probably killed on or just after Father's Day, June 20th. Edwina died of a single gunshot to the head. Fred, on Father's Day, was not so lucky. His autopsy concluded that he was beaten to death with a claw hammer, which was found in the house. The killer then gouged out his eyes and removed his genitals, which seems very personal considering the day. Obviously missing from the house was Charles, who police were very eager to talk with. A nationwide manhunt ensued for Charles Rogers, listed at 5'7" and approximately 140 pounds, and balding dark brown hair. Despite the coverage and subsequent manhunt, Charles Rogers had disappeared and was never heard from again. He was declared legally dead in 1975, the only real suspect in the brutal murder and dismemberment of his parents.
The son was declared legally dead in 1975, and soon after, the house on Driscoll Street was torn down. But the murders have not been forgotten by the community, the neighbors, or Officer Bullock.
I know for several months after that, I hesitated every time I opened a refrigerator.
In 1992, a book was published called The Man on the Grassy Knoll that purports that Charles was a CIA agent who, along with David Ferry and his associates, helped assassinate John F. Kennedy, and that he killed his parents because they knew too much. The book has been heavily criticized for a lack of sources for the author's claims and errors in the recounting of events. In 1997, a book called The Icebox Murders claimed the elderly Rogers were con artists who had been stealing money from their son on top of the abuse inflicted on him, and that Charles had been planning his parents' death for years before carrying it out and fleeing to Mexico, and was eventually killed by miners over a wage dispute. This book is also not well regarded. So what did happen on that Father's Day in Houston, Texas in 1965? The evidence tells us that Charles most likely brutally murdered and butchered his parents before disappearing into the night, never to be heard from again. But what happened to Charles after that? And what was the motive for such brutality? At this point, after so many years, we'll most likely never know. Thanks for watching. Stay safe, and have a good night.